There are all kind of questions about details of your lifetime, work, your relationship with your peers, the people that help you, people that perhaps did not help you. I don't like to go in detail on that because I think you have explained in detail most of it. But there's a very important society in the United States called the American Ophthalmological Society. And Dr. William Jarrett wanted to know, were you ever asked to be a member? And if not, why not? Then it goes on that he would like to know why were you ever interested in it or what happened?
Yes, I was asked to be a member when Dorman Pichel was a secretary. And it ended up that I was so busy the year I had to produce my thesis, and I really didn't have the time to make it ready in time. I had been sick for a couple of months that year. So I gave it up.
That's it. You have some questions?
Well, no, I just wanted to speak about Dr. Eller's question a little bit. He made an interesting comment that you wear overalls over your scrub suits and they, when you arrive and go from home to surgery. He wanted to know if you had any antidotes that ever happened to you when you
anecdotes.
Make this...
Anecdotes, yes.
With these overalls and scrub suits attire that you wear between the home and the operating
room. As to the reason why I did it?
Well, reason, yes, or but has anything ever happened to you in this sort of bizarre clothing?
Now, the reason why I do it is that I get up very early and I have to change clothes to go to the operating room. I get to the operating room, I have to change clothes again. Then at night I leave the operating room, I have to change clothes again. And I thought that's just too much wear and tear. So I go from my pajamas in my scrub suit, put overalls on, drive to the hospital, stay in that scrub suit all day, and then do a little work at the office if necessary, or go home. So I thought it's more convenient. I haven't had any problems with it, except that some people sometimes ask me if I can help them start their car or change their tire.
You know, Alice, it would be interesting to know how he first got the idea of indentation of the sclera. You know, the first one that did a buckle was in 1936 or 37, along the line, and he put a piece of just a, I think it was cotton, a suture.
Gauss
sponge.
J-E-S-S.
And where was that?
In Germany.
In Germany. That was the first buckle or procedure that you will probably...
Probably was, yes. But I didn't know that at the time. The way I got interested is that in 1950, there was a young doctor called Spira, S-P-I-R-A, from Lyon, who was a pupil of Pofik. And Pofik was doing lamellar scleral resections for retinal detachment. And Spira was very anxious to have me try. And I said to him, you know, the way you do it makes no sense to me because you put your lamellar resection just behind the insertion of the recti. Couldn't have any effect on your detachment, and the shortening you obtain is minimal. So if you want me to try, then I will put that scleral resection over the retinal break. That would be at the equator or near the equator, which I did, and it worked, but I quickly became aware that the indentation it produced was small and transitory. So I thought we must put something in there. Polyethylene at the time had become very, very much used. You know, all the tubes for IV and so on were polyethylene. So it was an obvious material to be used, which I did use. And then from just a piece of polyethylene, I came to the idea of a circling element which made it more permanent. Then later, 1959, it must be 1959, I learned from Dr. Rob MacDonald in Philadelphia that a friend of his who was a neurosurgeon in Montreal had abandoned completely the use of polyethylene sheets and polyethylene tubing in neurosurgery and was using a new compound named silicone. So I called the neurosurgeon, got the information, started to use silicone.
Well, what do you think about future implants that we should be striving to? How could we improve it?
I think there will be further changes. I think one change that is going to catch on very fast is hydrogel. Hydrogel is a new plastic material that was discovered by Refoco, which is very flexible, extremely elastic, extremely soft, as soft or softer than the softest silicone sponge. But it has pores that are too small to let a bacteria go through. It may let a virus through, but it wouldn't let bacteria through. It can be impregnated with any water-soluble antibiotic. So I think this will probably take the place of sponges. I think we still will need circling elements that are not made of hydrogel. Probably silicone is as good as any. Whether or not other elements will be found, I don't know, because you have to look for something that is really not absorbable, because if you look for a material that is absorbable or is integrated by the tissues, then you have a terrible time in reoperations, because you don't know where the choroidal plane is. You know, you may be 1 to 3 millimeters away from the choroid when you try and dissect in a reop. So I think we're sort of stuck with some form of plastic material.
You know, the polyethylene tube, and this is Bill Jarrett from Atlanta, created some cutting through intrusions and so forth, and there was a time where replacement had to be made of the tubes and difficulties, and Dr. Jarrett asked him that if you published an article on the complications, and there was an editorial comment at that time by Dr. Vail, the AAO, which in essence, I'm reading from Dr. Jarrett, said, "I told you so." And he says, "I don't recall any such editorial comment either before or since in the journals. And it seemed to me that this was not a very nice thing to say by someone in a position of authority. I really would like to know how Charles felt when he saw that particular comment in print accompanying a fine article which had to be published."
Well, there is a whole background to this. You see, we did our first scleral bucklings in 1949, 1950. Now, there came 1954, 55, 56. A lot of pressure was put on myself and my associates, Okumura at the time and Brockhurst, to publish. And I didn't want to publish because I knew that there were probably problems that were going to crop up longer term, and I wanted to wait and see so as to publish something more definitive. But the pressure was such from outside, particularly from Vail, that it should be published, that in 57 we started publishing a series of articles on it. Then 57, 58, we began to see erosion. So I immediately said, we've got to publish this, because if we don't, somebody else will, and it'll be worse. You know, so it's got to be published. And I could have said to Vail, "I told you so, it shouldn't have been published in 57, you know. But when we published the complications, Vail thought that was the condemnation of the procedure, and he was delighted. So that's the way it happened.
Do you think with our problems of erosion after, say, 20 years, 25 years, that maybe perhaps the use of the hydrogel might lessen some of the problems in the future?
I think there is no doubt about that. Of course, we'll know that in 20
years. Right.
But there is no doubt, because the hydrogel is like a very soft sponge, you see. And I think the tendency to erosion will be a great deal less.
But what about an encircling element like a collagen? Something of a collagen derivation that perhaps would be an encircling buckle give a circling and buckle effect for, say, 5 years or 7 years, and then gradually be absorbed. Wouldn't that be something to look forward to in the future that could be used in many cases?
That's a possibility. It will take a lot of time and effort, however, because in absorbable elements, there is always a great variability. You remember the problems with the catgut. You know, some absorb fast, some don't, and yet it's the same product. So that you'd have to be happy that the variability is not putting your patient at risk. So I think that would be a big effort for maybe not that big a payoff. I don't know. But it may be worth investigating.
You are a perfectionist to the fullest extent. And that is a defect in itself. I remember that you held on many, many articles when I was a fellow in the 1956, 57. Things that you were doing all that lateral intel work. You were doing all that inferior temporal dialysis of the young. Yet you did not polish your work. You in our retinal schisis, you gave him a new name. You in our retinal schisis was not even talked about until you start talking about it. Yet many of your pupils used that material when they went to their area, develop a name on the very thing that they learned from you over there. And your articles eventually came out. Your book was only published 3 years ago. But I remember for the past 15 years since I left my fellowship that there always in the literature that reflected your original work. And that is a defect in itself, that you will not publish a book until it was perfect. Well, 35 years went by before you published that book. And you know what? Your ideas sometimes are there, but they are not really told that they are your ideas. In other words, all of a sudden it becomes somebody else's ideas. And that is a defect. And when it comes to postpartum vitrectomy, that was a typical example of your work. You were working with Anton Banco and Tolentino on the finest vitrectomy instrument. You insisted that instrument should have an automatic suction device. You insisted that the instrument will have automatic infusion flow, that they will measure exactly the intraocular pressure while the surgery was being done. All of these are great things. But you know what? It was years and years and years before your ideas were accepted in other instruments. But yet your original instruments never became a very popular one, even though the idea of the automatic suction, you remember the stories, well, you know, I have control by suction, you know, by doing the manual suction. And you kept saying you cannot do that. So it was your idea, you were far ahead, and yet you sat around that instrument until it was perfect. Well, wouldn't you agree that in a way...
Well, I just think that's his... I wouldn't quite go along with all what you said, Felix, because I think that's the engineer in him, I think that's the scientist in him, I think that does make up... That's why you stated correctly, he's a perfectionist. At the same time, you're telling him that's being critical because of those of his characteristics. So
It delayed the introduction of certain things that he could have improved as you go along, rather than waiting until the last minute until it was just perfect.
Well, I remember the first several papers in the 50s, in the latter part of the 50s, where his papers, he wanted every sentence and every paragraph to be perfect. But there, with one paragraph and perhaps one or two sentences of complications, the fellows that left and the individuals he trained went out and took that one sentence or one paragraph, and they wrote several papers pertinent to one aspect of one complication or something.
Sorry.
But everything was a pearl. So I think it's all if you want quality or quantity. Mm-hmm. And I think the waiting for quality has a lot to be said for it. So to represent the other side of the argument.
I'll tell you the way.
Well, it always irritates me, though, that no credit is not given to him. That's the only part of it. As I say, you don't need the credit. You have more than anyone will have in three or four lifetimes. But let's talk about cryo a little bit. You wanted to say something about
it. Yes.
Let him defend himself.
I don't want to defend it or attack it. All I want to say is how I feel about it. It depends what your aim in life is. You know, if you want to publish a lot, then you publish the minute you have something. Never mind if you have to make another publication to say that the first paper was wrong. On the contrary, that makes two papers instead of one. But if you want to progress, and if you're only interested in accomplishment, publication becomes ancillary. And that's the way I feel. I'm not in any rush to publish, you know. And the only reason I published the book is that I said, well, I might be sick, I might never publish it, so I better go ahead and do something.
I think that he has a great gift of not having to rely on publish or perish theme, you know, of many of our universities or colleges to get the promotion within a department. They must have so many number of publications. Fortunately, you're blessed to have not had that strain on you.
That's right. I can give you a recent example. 2 years ago, Tatsuo and I developed on paper a retinal tack, which would be just fantastic. But it's a little complex to fabricate, and I drew it on paper. I still have the drawings. We never got around to even try it, you know. Well, a very nice Japanese fellow wrote a paper, which I edited several times before it was published, about retinal tacks. And certain groups in this country now are making a big fuss about retinal tacks. But actually, nobody knows if they're better than sutures, which we have used, retinal sutures, which we have used for years now. But what's the big rush about publishing all that? You know, it may all be junk if somebody else comes up with something better. So there is good and bad to say about publishing fast.
All right.
Because what you publish fast may be an error the next week.
Spending more time retracting it.
But that's the case, but there's no retraction after all. It's just hope that it's forgotten.
Oh, that's right.
Now, cryopexy, you know, there are several advantages, and again, the criticisms always come. Oh, Dr. Schepens will not accept anything that is not really originated at the Retina Foundation. Now, that's not a fair criticism, of course, I know that. And photocoagulation came about, and I know you were working on photocoagulation because I was a fellow with the mercury arc light lamp.
Yes.
Remember,
mm-hmm.
We treated Medicare way before anyone came up with the photocoagulation. And I know that you developed your own xenon photocoagulation with indirect ophthalmoscopy. But your main criticism of photocoagulation was that it was an outdated system that was a direct ophthalmoscopy that needed to be an indirect ophthalmoscopy. I think, of course, slit lamp came around, and that was a different approach. Do you feel that, in a way, the field of photocoagulation with lasers, and you haven't talked about Pomerantz, I know you will talk later on about it, but do you feel that there is a further advancement to be made in that field that are not being made at this time?
Very much so. You see, the big problem I see with photocoagulation is that on the one side you have very good clinicians, and on the other side you have physicists. And these two groups don't talk to each other very much. In fact, how many clinicians do you think are consulted when a laser fabricator manufactures an instrument? You know? I don't think that they manufacture the instrument in general, because it's clinically better. It's only if they think they can make money out of it.
I see.
You see? And because of a gap in knowledge on the clinician's part on one side, on the physicist's part on the other side, the field is not progressing as fast as it should. But I think that the ultimate has not been developed yet. I think the instruments are too complex and too expensive. I think there are other methods to obtain this kind of light, which have not been developed. I think that the clinicians don't know enough about the various effects of the wavelengths. They don't know enough about the effects of light on the retina, period, paragraph. And as long as that knowledge gap exists, you know, there'll be very slow development.
What would be the ideal laser photocoagulator?
Well, I'd like to see a laser coagulator that can produce all the wavelengths plus including the infrared, in one instrument that costs $10,000.
Everybody's dream would be nice.
How about the amount of absorption and the work that Pomerantz have done in trying to control the delivery?
I think that's very important. It's very important because the laser light only has an effect where it is absorbed, where the light is transformed into heat. Okay, because the laser light has no infrared rays per se, except if you take an infrared laser. But they have only one wavelength, which is called light. So the amount of absorption in any layer of the retinal choroid will determine the degree of the burn. Now, what is not absorbed is mostly reflected, and the amount reflected represents the segment of light which is not absorbed. So if you can measure how much is reflected, you can quickly calculate how much must be absorbed, because it has no other place where to go. So you could imagine a system which automatically measures the light reflected at any wavelength and would set your instrument exactly for that amount, that is duration, exposure duration, and number of milliwatts. And that might save a lot of problems because, you know, people talk a lot about photocoagulation, but very few people tell you how many problems they've had, how many hemorrhages they've had.
Sure.
And we all have had hemorrhages. Nobody can say he never did have a hemorrhage. So I think there is an area where safety could be increased substantially.
Now, cryopexy. For a while, there was a tremendous controversy about cryopexy, diatomy. Each mode of treatment is finding its place. You did some of the... Tell us a little bit about cryopexy. Who was the first one who used cryo in the retina?
Bieti used carbonic snow on the retina in 1933-34.
I see.
And Bieti was a friend of Gunderson, and he came to Boston in 1948-49. He's the one who sent Grignolo in training.
I see.
And he asked me, what do you think about freezing? Would that be any good? And I had him explain how he was doing the freezing. And we did a couple of animals at the time. But, you know, it was so hard to control the extent that I said to him, I don't think it will ever. He said, I agree with you. I don't think it's...
And yet it became popular afterwards.
Mm-hmm. It came popular later when it was easier to control, you know, with liquid air and later with carbon dioxide, you could make a smaller spot. Still not a very small spot, but smaller. And we use cryo. I'm not the mortal enemy of cryo. We use cryo a lot, but not universally. Many people who talked as if they were the mortal enemies of diathermy really never use diathermy as it should be. That is on a thin or thin sclera and on a dry field and making small sparse spots. But now, you see, everything comes into sort of a head with the recent work done by the group at Wilmer, where they demonstrated on an animal model that if you have a large break, cryo produces a lot more PVR than diathermy.
I see.
And I think this is not because cryo is such an extraordinarily innocuous element. I think it's suddenly a factor of the area and the volume, the cellular volume that is destroyed.
But yet, you know, if you look at the time of the scleral resection, careful diatomy, careful localization of the tear, and the sponge come around with cryopexy, it popularized the retinal detachment surgery in the hands of those who were not really well-trained or qualified to do retinal surgery. Would you agree with that statement?
Absolutely.
So therefore, you have a tiny little horseshoe tear open temple, and you put a large buckle, and of course, you cry all of that upper temporal area. So we're going back, and we're going back to the old times of the ball electrode in diathermy and the tremendous amount of destruction of retina, except that we have now an element like it's a sponge, which actually takes a lot of space. So simple cases are being over-treated, would you say? Maybe. And the idea of studying carefully a case, that a drawing, that art is being lost slowly because of the expediency of the sponge and cryo. And
you see, the sponge and cryo and no scleral dissection is a very much quicker procedure. You spend much less time in the OR. It's somewhat less precise and more diffuse in its effect, but you save a lot of time, and you don't have to be a great expert.
I think with the cryo probe, you can place it over a suspicious area, and one cryo mark can light up whether or not it's a tiny horseshoe or just a vitreoretinal tag. Prior to cryo, you know, we had to spend more time looking and drawing preoperatively, because it would mean putting a dissection there or using diathermy.
But if again, it's treating an area that may not need to be treated.
Exactly, and I think it's giving shortcuts to our residents and fellows of being perhaps a little sloppier in their examination. Because they can feel, well, we can always cover a suspicious tag with a cryo mark.
You're absolutely right, and there is no perfect system to irritate the choroid and pigment epithelium in retinal detachment cases. And all the present system work in most cases. It's only a matter of whether or not you gain 1% or a small percentage using this method rather than that method. But the differences are not that great in simple cases.
Now we're talking about simple cases. Let's go into the most difficult cases, the PBR. And there has been quite a bit of work on gases to be used intraocular, silicone. I just saw a patient a week ago that Hal Freeman has done 13 years ago with silicone. The only eye, the retina is attached, she had 2400, the other eye is gone. She still functions with that eye 13 years later. Silicone is still inside the eye. Do you feel there is a place for silicone? Do you feel there's a place, certainly for gas, in those difficult cases?
There's no doubt that there is a place for silicone-like materials. This is a material which is non-absorbable, which is viscid, which is transparent, which is non-inflammatory, non-antigenic, no question. But, you know, what happens today with silicone is that after many gyrations, silicone comes back from Europe as the panacea. I've been to Europe, I've seen what they do, you know. In some clinics, they inject silicone in every case, even when there is not even a retinal break, just areas of degeneration. And I think that's a vast exaggeration. You see, this will change and change rapidly, and I'll tell you why. There are cases of death reported from silicone injection in tissues other than the eye. And for that reason, it has been forbidden by law in France to inject silicone elsewhere than in the eye. They've died from emboli in the brain. There are two cases reported, also in France, that resulted in acute pulmonary distress shortly after operation. And because the surgeon was smart, the anesthetist was smart, they got the sputum from the bronchi, and the sputum was filled with foam cells and with silicone, the nature of which was determined chemically. It's not that they thought it was silicone. It was silicone. So the silicone somehow found its way from the orbit into the lungs.
This was intraocular silicone.
3 cc's of intraocular silicone, but you know what happened, I think. It's not at the time of injection, and it's not through the eye, it's when they remove the silicone. The silicone went all over the open wound, and from there, that's what I think, that's what I surmise. But you know, this, when a patient, it'll have to be that whenever we inject silicone, we'll have to tell the patient, you may have acute pulmonary distress, you know, and we cannot guarantee that it cannot cause death. Now, how many will sign a consent? And if you don't, and you have such a case, and the plaintiff happens to know the literature well, which will happen sooner or later, you can foresee the consequences.
1958, you had a ladder in the operating room. We tied the patient to the ladder. You put it upside down.
Right.
That was just the beginning of all the upside down surgery.
Right.
Just nobody mentioned that you were the first one. You had a table that was designed along those lines. And you used air at that time to put the retina back in position.
Right.
So you used gas. What stopped you from moving into the other gases, the one that actually increased the volume as you are?
Well, I'm still not clear as to just how effective gases are. I know what they do. And I know that you can use mixtures that will last longer, but it strikes me that the longer a gas lasts, the more innocuous it becomes. If you leave a gas, a long-lasting gas, in contact with the healthy lens of a rabbit more than 4 days, he has permanent lens opacities. And this has been described in humans. I don't know about the length of time, but you know, this is a well-known fact. So that, okay, gases have several advantages. You know, they can swell post-op. They can turn from liquid to gas and, you know, occupy more space gradually. They can push the vitreous away. I have never been totally convinced that those results which I described are better than what I currently do in similar cases. What I do in similar cases, I do a vitrectomy, I do an air-liquid exchange, fill the cavity with air. Then I do a hyaluronic acid air exchange. The reason why I do that, each time there is 2 cc or more of air in the vitreous cavity, is that I see a lot better when I inject the hyaluronic acid. When I inject air, you know, there are still many questions looking around the fundus. It's difficult to be sure. The hyaluronic acid stays a lot longer. Now, it has been said, well, it doesn't stay long enough. It should stay 3 months. Now, 3 months, what's the magic of 3 months? Because somebody said so? I mean, who knows how long it has to stay? But I agree it doesn't stay long enough. We don't know how long hyaluronic acid stays in a viscous form in a human eye that has had multiple reoperations, whose metabolism is very low. We only know what happens in a monkey eye of a young monkey who's never been operated on before. So that comparison may not really hold.
I see. So you're using a mixture of gas, I mean, air and hyaluronic
acid. An exchange. I do a double exchange. I first replace the liquid from the BSS with air. Because you cannot do an exchange from hyaluronic acid to BSS, because hyaluronic acid is soluble in BSS, and all you do is dilute the hyaluronic acid. So you put air in first, and then exchange air with hyaluronic acid.
Do you have any trouble with glaucoma, or does it increase the post-op inflammation at all?
Sometimes you have glaucoma, but never. You see, it doesn't swell post-op. So it's not the same as an expanding gas. But sometimes you do get glaucoma. Yes, you do get an inflammatory reaction, which is not visible in the young, healthy, unoperated monkey, but which is well visible in an older patient who has had multiple operations. And it does not stay as clear, the hyaluronic acid, as silicone, because silicone is not water miscible. Therefore, the cells do not penetrate the silicone. They cannot penetrate the silicone. So the silicone stays clear. The hyaluronic acid may take 2 days, 3 days, 4 days to clear up.
Yeah. I've got some questions there. I have one more here from Dr. Jarrett, and these are all interesting questions. And he actually he he feels that this may be a below the belt question. But we're here, we're going to ask it. I said, it may be possibly unfair, but it has been my observation that in the early years, the real talented and capable prospects were attracted to Schepens program in Boston. One think of the great names of retinal detachment surgeon in the late 50s and early 60s. He goes on, a group of people that are very well recognized, and a host of others who have done superior work and who have made their own marks in ophthalmology. Yet it appears that the best candidates are not anymore applying to the Boston program. It says here, I'm sure this can be worded in a kind of fashion. Well, I don't have the knowledge of the English language to say so, but I wonder whether you could comment on it. I have my own opinion of it, but I'd like to hear yours.
Well, my opinion is this, you see. How can we tell that Dr. X, who's been out 2 years or 1 year, is going to be a great name 20 years from now? Did you know you were going to be a great name?
Thank you.
Did you know I was going to be a great name?
No, I'm sure it
is. I lied to my
grandchildren about it, but anyway.
I had my thoughts about that, but it's very difficult. And to make a fair comparison, we should be 20 years hence and compare those of 50 years ago to those of 25 years ago. Then we could make a fair comparison. I disagree that we don't get top candidates. We don't get all the top candidates. And you know, some candidates are interviewed by us and go elsewhere, and vice versa. But we have a batch of candidates whom I think are very, very good. Now, whether they'll become as famous or, you know, as you people were, that's hard to tell. That depends on circumstances.
Right. The opportunities.
Yeah. Opportunity.
20 years ago, there were a lot more opportunities than there are now.
Let's not forget that. There were not that many retina surgeons.
That's right.
Now, as to progress in research and number of articles published, you know, I would agree that we don't publish that many papers, but this is more a policy than the fact that we have no material. I think also that overall the Institute and the associates have moved much more medically. We have a huge activity in medical retina, to which people 15, 20 years ago were not exposed, you know. And the medical retina at the Associates was really created by Clem Tramp. That didn't exist before him. And I think that's a feather in his cap, no question. It's very important. It was neglected before because everybody was so busy doing surgeries, you know. So that, you know, you have to look at both, all the sides of that picture. It's not that simple, cut and dry picture.
I remember Dr. Schwartz had written in, I just don't have his question precisely here, but he did ask the question that he thinks we're training too many vitreoretinal surgeons in the United States. And by so doing, of course, surgical experience is decreasing. And he wondered what you thought about the long term, the quality of their type of care or the type of surgery with their less experience. Is that going to be influenced?
You know, Alice, I am going to say something maybe I shouldn't say. I should say, I told you so. I told the Retina Society so 7 years ago, and I pushed as hard as I could publicly and individually to do something about trying to control the training programs that would be approved or disapproved by Retina Society, and nobody dared touch that. So now they're suffering for their own lack of foresight, and it's only going to get worse. You haven't seen the beginning yet. You know, there are many, too many people who call themselves vitreoretinal surgeon and who are not well trained. And this will get worse because, you know, with the HMOs and so on, it will not be who can do the best job. It will be who could do a buckle for the least money. Right. And that is a very bad way to measure work.
Right. And could you give us your opinion regarding 3 months fellowship versus 1 year fellowship versus a 2 year program?
Well, it depends, you see. I think a 3 months fellowship is close to valueless. You know, in a 3 months fellowship, in many cases, you don't get more than you get in a good residency, where you get 3 months of exposure to retina work. I think a good fellowship, either medical or surgical retina, should be a year. If you want to join both, it should be 2 years or more, depending how much, you know, you want to train them.
You know, Dr. Schwartz asked a question here. Which patients stand out most in your memory, the successes or the failures?
Depends if I'm in a good mood or in a bad mood. When I'm depressed, I think of the failures. In long term, I think of the successes more than the failures. Short term, I think of the failures much more than the successes, particularly when they're tragic ones.
Can I ask a question from Dr. Jabor? He asked the question that, or stated first the fact that you've taught us and so many students so many valuable things, but what is the most important thing you would not want any of your students to ever forget?
The most important thing that they should never forget is that in all situations they have to put themselves in the patient's shoes. And the second most important thing is that it doesn't matter how unpleasant or difficult the patient is, thorough work is the hallmark of any good vitreoretinal specialist. Because without thorough work, you know, they're going to miss all kinds of things.
That's very good. He also wanted to, he's asked a very interesting question. Who is your hero? So you're a hero to many of us, but who is your hero?
Well, again, here it depends on what I'm thinking of, you know. If I think of my own profession, my hero is Oleg Pomerantsev. Because there is a man whom I knew when I was 14 years of age. I went to the same boarding school as he went to. And there was a kid who had nothing, not even a shirt to put on his back. And he didn't know French. He learned French, and in 3 years, he completed 6 years of high school. It's a combination of high school and the beginning of college. You know, those 6 years. And he came out in a very competitive school, first in every subject, including French and Flemish and you name it. He was a fantastic sportsman. He could sing like a nightingale. You know, he could do everything. So I became very friendly with him. And when in our student years at university, he and I decided that we would work together in medicine. I felt very badly he didn't go in medicine, but he became an engineer, and that we would use his engineering skills to improve medicine. You know, that did not happen. And there came the war. And after the war, I invited him to the United States. But then was the Korean War, 1950. And he was considered an enemy alien because he was born in Petrograd. And Russia was an enemy country during the Korean War, so he couldn't immigrate. It took 2 years for the Korean War to wind down. He got his visa. 2 weeks earlier, he'd signed a contract to go to Brazil. So he went to Brazil. He was there for 12 years. Then he accidentally killed his wife in a terrible car accident. She was instantly killed. He was unharmed. So he got so desperate that he wrote me and said, now if you want me to come now, if you don't think I'm too old, I'll come over. So he came over, and he had never done any optics. And I said, if you don't know optics, you know, I can't use you. You have to learn optics. So I checked with the Department of Astronomy at Harvard, and we sent him to the School of Optics in Paris, which is one of the best schools existing. is a four-year program. And I said, we'll give you a fellowship for 4 years. You go. So 6 months later, he was back. And I said, what are you doing here? He said, I apologize. I could have waited until May and take the exam, but I didn't want to waste the time. I said, the exam, but that's the first year. He said, no, no, I'm talking about the final exam. He'd done it 4 years and 6 months.
Amazing.
And he passed the exams? He passed all those exams?
First year. Every year exam, he just didn't wait for the last exam.
Oh, I see.
Fantastic. He then came to Boston and worked at Optics, and today, when you look at the sum total work he's done, he is the father of modern ophthalmological optics. There's no question about that. No question. You know, he's done a tremendous job. He's been with us 25 years now. He's 75 years old. He has a program that will give him 15 years more work without any doubt. And he works like a beaver, in spite of the fact that he had a very severe heart operation that nearly killed him just about a year ago. He's completely recovered and back to work.
Mm. It's tremendous. Well, we all respect Dr. Pomerantz a great deal. Dr. DeBoer had one more question. He just wanted to know, of all your great things that you've done in your life, what do you think has been your greatest accomplishment?
Well, that's a tough question.
It is.
I don't think there is any single item. The two things that I'm most pleased about, which are not all of my doing, is number one, that circumstances have permitted me to improve the prognosis of retinal detachment operations. And number two, again, that many friends, and you're not one of the smallest one, Alice, have, and you too, Felix, have helped me to establish the Eye Research Institute, which I think has done and is still doing outstanding work. Of course, you know, the kind of work they do only shows outside years after the work has been done.
Sure.
But I can tell you, it's packed with all kinds of things, all kinds. In retina and cornea, is just amazing. Of course, I didn't do that work, you know, I was just a facilitator. But I'm very proud to be associated with so many young, brilliant people like the two of you here and many others who are not here. That is my proudest accomplishment.
You know, Dr. Schwartz, go back to patients, and as regard to patient gratitude for your care, have you found much correlation with what you consider successful or unsuccessful? And how did patient feel about your care?
Not at all. You can take a cinder out of a patient and give you $1 million. Mm-hmm. And the other extreme is that there was a one-eyed woman that came from Brooklyn. She had a very severe phakic detachment. I fixed her. The day of her discharge, I went to see her, and she looked pale and clammy and really sick. And I called the medical man, and he diagnosed an embolus in the pulmonary artery. And she was rushed top speed to the surgical floor. In 20 minutes, her chest was opened, and her life was saved. She hated me. She said, how come? For a little eye business. Look at the incision here.
Well, but she's in good health now. I mean, yeah. And then Dr. Schwartz asked, too, looking over your rich experience in vitreous retinal surgery, do you have any regrets about any aspect of your professional life in this area?
Well, while he's thinking, could I say Dr. Pappas asked a very similar question. Besides regrets, he asked, is there any part of your career that you would do differently? And thinking back about any of the regrets.
Well, there are two things that I could have done differently. I don't know how you would have worked, but I could have done differently. One is that I was too outspoken and not diplomatic enough, and an outstanding example of that is my answer when the dean irritated me you know, and I gave him that snap answer. That was not very smart.
Not to the dean of Harvard.
Don't do that to the dean of Harvard, you know. Another is that Dunphy got very impatient with me because I was blatantly critical of the system. He said, if you don't like it, why don't you leave? You
know? Yes, Americans don't like the people to come over and criticize too
much. Well, Europeans don't like that either. But okay, that's one thing I could have done better. The other thing is that I've been invited to go elsewhere. Who was the predecessor of Ruiz in Houston? A nice old man.
No, that's Dallas. That was Dallas. That was Dallas.
No, Houston. Houston. He asked
Gore.
Gore. That was Baylor. That was Baylor, not University of Houston.
Everett asked me to move to there. Post asked me to move to St. Louis.
Well, Houston wanted to build you a building and a foundation.
I know.
They couldn't learn down there.
I know. But maybe that was a mistake. I don't know. I don't know how it would have worked out, you know. But you never know. You can't relive those experiences.
Dr. Pappas had another, I think, very good question. He wanted to know, are there any dreams or plans that you feel that have still remained unfulfilled?
Many.
That's
many.
You have another 25 years planned, too, like
older. Oh, another lifetime.
You won't want to share any of them with us?
Yes, I'll tell you. From a very practical standpoint, I think there are substantial improvements that can be made in lasers. We touched on that. And it may be that a not too expensive laser that can do everything, you know, can and should be developed as possible. In vitrectomy, I think that there is a considerable opportunity that's being missed by combining the experience of closed and open sky vitrectomy. I think both have features that are outstanding, and if they could be combined, a lot more would be gained, and many cases would become operable that are not today operable. So that those are little things. In the bigger, more distant things, I think a lot can be expected from two sources. One is cell biology, where today it's not outlandish to expect that if you find the trigger to stimulate a cell, you can make a cell do anything. You can have a glial cell that proliferates like mad. You could make any cell fabricate hyaluronic acid right there on the spot. I mean, this is feasible. You have to find a way to turn them on. But this is feasible too. So there is a great future. The other area is immunology. You know, we've gotten nowhere with uveitis. Antimetabolites, you know, can be useful. They can also be deadly, and nobody talks much about how many people they killed with antimetabolites. We don't know what brings on uveitis, and we certainly don't know how to help severe cases of uveitis. And I think the answer is in the immunology laboratories. And many of the answers may be there and not really exploited, you know. What we need is full-time immunologists with an interest in the eye, talking to clinicians with an interest in immune disease of the eye. And I think those are two great future areas.
Well, don't you think there's been such as in the last two or three decades such a boom in retina research where at one time was totally ignored, like in the 40s and 50s, and even under your guidance and work, the retinal detachment reattachment rate has gone. Would you say in the 40s to was about 40% up to about 93% now, with all the advances? And now if we can go back and learn how the normal retina will work physiologically and neurologically, and we can perhaps even have more breakthroughs.
And, you know, and Dr. Schwartz asked the same question. What do you think, what do you see as the major scientific problem facing our specialty today?
Well, it depends how you look at it. You see, the major unsolved clinical problem facing retinal specialists today is probably macular degeneration, because it's much more frequent in retinal detachment, just no comparison. And we know much less about it than we know about retinal detachment. We know little enough about retinal detachment, but less about macular degeneration. How does it happen? What turns on the, what's the triggering process? How can you prevent it? And outside of a few spots of further coagulation, which sometimes do wonders, sometimes don't work so well, what can we do to cure it?
Dr. Chandra went back to a very large subject, too. He just was interested in knowing what was your advice to help the human race.
Well, I think to help the human race, we have to solve, first of all, we have to solve very basic, simple problems. For instance, what is the relation between exposure to light and eye disease? You know, light is accused of causing cataracts. Light is accused of causing macular degeneration. What do we know about this? How much do we know? Very little. You know, that, if we knew that, it could help the human race all over, there's no question. The other thing is, how do we best teach in advanced countries, how do we best spread our knowledge to less advanced countries? And I think that's a very difficult problem, and nobody has the answer. I am one who happens to think that it's not particularly useful to send young men from less advanced countries to the United States, because 80% of them will try to stay here, and when they return, they'll be unwelcome, and they will not be helped. So I think maybe the way to do it is to send people like us here, down there, and do a job for a time, and then go away.
You teach the other ophthalmologists
in that area. Teach the other ophthalmologists down there.
But we also must leave them with the equipment, and I mean, or somehow, so many skilled surgeons, perhaps like from the Latin American countries, and they have the ability, but perhaps are missing the correct instrument, or they don't have the technology there.
Alice, this is absolutely right. And the first time I went to South America, I went with Charlie Regan, and we had 5 sets of retina equipment, including ophthalmoscope stand, diathermy, everything. We went to 5 places and left a set in each place. And I think this was donated. In those days, it cost $3,000 for a total complete set. So $15,000.
That's for the ophthalmoscope now.
That's right. So I think you're right. This is the kind of thing that should be done more and more. I don't think it's useful to bring young people here. I don't think it's useful to go there with a big, showy system and demonstrate to them the latest.
Like, shall I mention the word Orbis or not?
Yes, that's right. You see, I think this is too expensive, and it creates envy more than it educates.
Dr. Jabour stated here that he has come to know many members of your family, and he personally feels that you have been leading a very happy marriage and prosperous family life. We went over that early for so many years. At the same time, you work many, many hours. And what is the secret of your dual success? I think Cette can give you the answer to that, that you really get. But how about your opinion?
Yeah, but she won't willingly do so. You know her. I think the secret is, number one, you have to love each other. Number two, you have both got to be willing to invest enough in each other. And the mistake that many youngsters make, they say, I have invested enough in her. You know, when you reach that point, you have to realize that you're about at the 50% level, that you are to invest double that much before the partner feels that you have invested enough.
May I interrupt, though? What are you investing? Care or interest or quality or love? Not I mean, we're not talking about anything like
giving
money
in,
or
giving in.
More emotional aspects.
Giving in to the desires or the emotions of the other, you know. Compromising, accepting. I think that is just about essential.
Dr. Gottlieb wanted to ask you a question too. He'd like to know, do you feel yourself a citizen of the United States, of Belgium, of both, or the entire world?
Well, that's an interesting question. I was telling Felix last night, when I'm in the United States, I feel like a Belgian. When I'm in Belgium, I feel like an American. And when I'm elsewhere, I feel like a citizen of the world.
For example, in India. Oh, by the way, that would be. Tell us about India and your trips there. I know you go frequently.
Well, it's a fascinating country. I think it's the most fascinating country in the world. Of course, you cannot really stand being there very long if you cannot accept to look at what misery really is, you know. People dying on the sidewalk and things like that. Those things exist today. If you go in the proper districts, you know, in, not in the proper districts, in the adequate districts, you'll find those places. They were shown to me. However, the Indian is so tolerant, so patient, accepts everything, you know. We, as Europeans, go into a temple where there is every activity and every type of dress. Nobody ever turns around and says, look at those Westerners. They don't pay any attention. They all go about their business. They're tolerant to suffering to a fantastic degree. They have unlimited patience, unlimited. And there is a great lesson to be learned. You know, the women in the country are poor, very poor, but they're dressed like ladies. They're just fabulous. They hold themselves very straight. They carry loads on their head, you know. They have those saris that drapes them in a very elegant fashion. They're so much more beautiful than the average Westerner. So I got to like them very, very much. Of course, they're not very effective. They don't always listen to advice, you know. They tolerate to see suffering around them to a degree that's unbelievable, but if they didn't, I don't think they'd survive in that country. However, some groups of them are fantastic workers. That family that I know at the southern tip of India, in Madurai, they're 2-4 children. The eldest one didn't get married because he had rheumatoid arthritis and his fingers and toes are completely deformed. He's the ophthalmologist. The others are married. So when he retired from his professorial appointment, he was promised by the state to be given land where he could build a hospital to take care of the poor. Well, he never got the land. So he organized a family reunion, and he told the other three, what you're going to do, you're going to help me build a hospital. And what I want is 250 beds, 5 stories. And they said, who's going to pay for that? He said, you're going to pay for it. You're a contractor. You'll do the building, and you'll borrow the money. So it cost them $2 million, which they borrowed. They built a hospital. Within 5 years, the hospital was paid off completely. Then now they've built another 250 beds for the totally poor, who have not a single penny. Maybe some of them never even saw money in their lives. And there, it cost them the cost of one cataract, diagnosis, pre-op care, operation, and a week in the hospital. It's a week because they only can afford to put 2 sutures in. It costs $25. So this money is raised locally. You know, a guy will say, I'll give you 1,000 cataracts. You know, that's $25,000. And so on. Now they're building satellite hospitals. And I say to them, how many do you want to build? They said, 15. How much will they cost? He said, it'll cost us $50,000 for 100 beds. I said, you'll never raise that money. Well, they've already built three. These people are really totally dedicated, and I want to help them because those are people who know how to help themselves. They don't come for a handout.
Yes, that could answer some of the questions I received about what goals or what your interest is in the future. Dr. Lozano had asked a question that we all know how much satisfaction and happiness your profession has given you all along your life. In your opinion, what other undertaking would have given you as much? Was there anything else besides ophthalmology? I know you had spoken earlier about the interest in engineering, but after looking back over all this, do you think that ophthalmology has ended up to be your first?
You know, I don't know, because I've had opportunities to do other things. During the war, I was running a lumber concern. And
many interests.
When I got back to England, I didn't want to do ophthalmology. I wanted to stay in the lumber business, a fascinating business. So I can't answer that. You don't know unless you try. You know, you don't know how much satisfaction you get out of a business unless you really try and, you know, you plunge into it.
Seems to me you would have been a very good CIA agent, too.
Yes.
You might have missed your calling there.
You know, Dr. Pruitt says you have always urged your students to be perfectionists, drawing the fundus and vitreous diagrams in surgery, in research, even staying fit. Many of us have concluded that your philosophy is first is good, but best is better. That is, lead the field with quality. Do you think that's a fair statement?
Yes.
How do you stay fit?
I try to watch my health, I try to watch my diet, I try to do moderate amount of exercise. Often I don't do enough when I'm, you know, all involved in something I forget. But I think that's very important.
About the swimming and the cold weather of Nahan, you still do that?
Oh, that's the most stimulating thing. I get all my good ideas in that cold water.
How long do you stay swimming there?
20 minutes.
20 minutes. And the cold, it's very cold in November.
It gets cold.
It must be like the polar bear club.
Yes. The
temperature must really be low.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, you could do that and do it through the winter if I went every day faithfully, which I cannot quite do. So I don't want, it's too risky. You know, when it gets really cold, I stay up.
But Seth worries a lot about it. She keeps watching you all the time when you get into this.
Yes, because you see, in wintertime, I have to get up at 5:15 and it's pitch dark.
I see.
And I go swimming, it's pitch dark.
I would agree with Seth, though.
That's very dangerous, the rocks.
Dr. Hidenao Hideta from Japan has two questions. What is your happiness? What you're doing now?
Well, I think what makes me most happy is to be able to solve a problem, to find a solution to something that there was apparently no solution. I think that's the greatest thing. And that's why I'm so interested in the Eye Research Institute, because these boys find solutions to unsolved problems. And vicariously, you know, I derive pride and happiness from that.
And the other question is, what is the meaning of your life?
Well, that's difficult to answer, but I think that basically I'm a human being who has received a tremendous amount on this earth. I had decent parents, I had wonderful brothers and sisters, I was brought up under optimal circumstances. I went to good schools. I have a brain that works when so many others have to work with a brain that doesn't quite work. So I feel I have a tremendous debt and I have to pay back, and I can never pay back enough. And to me, that's the meaning of my life, that I want to be able to pay back for others to have a chance to be somewhat happy.
Dr. Jabbour had a question along those lines. He said, as a scientist, what are your views about God?
You know, I think God, or belief in God, has nothing to do with science. You have the greatest scientist who's never given one thought about whether or not there is a God or there isn't a God. And the dumbest, the Dickens, about that particular problem. I think my views on God derive from the milieu in which I was educated and from the friends I've had. I believe in God profoundly. I was brought up as a Catholic. I think Catholicism has failed in some respects because they go now through a very difficult period. But basically, I think Christianity is the only religion that explains to me the basic problems of life, which are, how is it possible that a God who is all-knowing, and in which I believe, and infinitely good, can stand for a world that is totally unfair? Not only in humans, but look at plants. Look how greedy plants are. They kill each other. Look at animals. Insects eat each other alive. And so on, all through nature. Christianity developed a system by which they say, okay, you humans, you have an afterlife. And the meaning of the afterlife is for equality. If you were given too much in this life and you didn't give back enough, you'd be punished. If you've given too little in this life, you'll be elevated. So the boat will make an equilibrium. And to me, that is more satisfactory to explain this tremendous mystery of this unfair world in which we live, by which we are surrounded. It's the only way I can conceive of, which to me makes sense. I don't like the Buddhist system, which is a great religion too, where they say, well, you will go through several lives and you will pay for your mistakes in one life by going into a second and a third, and gradually you will be purified and perfected until you go back to God. If this were so, how come we are unconscious about the previous life? We have no way to know or be sorry about the previous life. We seem to know nothing about it. So I think that's a flaw in their system. So that's my feeling about
very good
God.
Philosophy.
Very good.
I hate to ask this. Do you have any questions there? Because I have a question now after you saying this, that this is not really coming up.
Well,
coming down too low on this, but...
let me ask perhaps Dr. Ho would have the question. This gets back a little bit to the fellowship program, but he wants to know whether or not you would recommend to a young doctor to subspecialize in, quotes, retina, and what he should do and where he should go after the subspecialization. He wondered, what would your thoughts be on that? What advice to give a young graduating
student?
Today? Yes, today, a young resident just leaving a program.
Well, I think life today for a young vitreoretinal specialist is tough, and the outlook is not bright. Just isn't. Where are they going to go? It depends on what they want to do. If they want to see lots of patients, and treat them, where would they go? There is an oversupply of self-appointed vitreoretinal surgeons. And they know all the methods. They know indirect ophthalmoscopy, and they know how to press the buttons of a photocoagulator. That's all they have to know to be able to charge and treat. So I think those boys are really in a quandary. Unless they want to do some additional work in research or special training or go in an academic position, I really wouldn't know where I would recommend a brilliant one to go, except in an institution like yours or ours, where there is already, a certain cadre, and these institutions will probably continue for a number of years. But I see more and more of these boys being tempted to go in high-flying outfits that advertise in the Sunday paper and so on. And I certainly cannot condone that or advise that. So we are really in a situation where of change. We don't know just where it's going to end, and we really are not equipped to give a good answer to the young men.
Yes, it's changed so much in the last 30 years.
Even in the last 5 years.
5 years, yes, everything so rapidly.
Right.
I think too many of them are self-appointed, as you say, that they are retina specialists, but the public has very little way of knowing the qualifications or background training.
And again, this brings out the sad failing of the Retina Society. They've done nothing about it.
Oh, the Retina Society is trying very hard to correct some of those things.
It is, you know,
we all love the Retina Society.
The horse is out of the barn, Alice, as far as the program
goes. Oh, I think we're going to be good chasers of those horses.
Nice scabbers. Dr. Jeshwar, ask a question. Will internal repair of rheumatogenous retinal detachment by vitrectomy, retinotomy, internal drainage, and photocoagulation with internal tamponade replace external scleral buckling with transscleral diathermy or cryo and external fluid release?
I don't think it's sensible to imagine that it will replace the external manipulations in so-called simple cases, because in my opinion, everything mentioned there, done internally with instruments penetrating in the eye, is quite a bit more dangerous than external manipulations. And I think in many cases, it's unjustified. You see, we mustn't forget that in the days of the polyethylene tube, we cured a number of PVR D5, or what is it, D5 or DC, I forget now. But the highest degree, the worst degree, quite a number of them were cured with the circling element. And today you talk to surgeons, and if they have a D3, they want to do a vitrectomy first thing. I think that's often a mistake. And I see a number of complications that are, and you know what they are, you know. Additional holes in the retina, hemorrhage, incarceration in the perforation site of vitreous, or worse, of retina. And then those cases become inoperable by any method. However, I think that for severe cases, the internal procedures have given us very effective new arms to be more successful in severe cases, and perhaps get better vision in those more severe cases. I don't know that, but that could be. So I think we have to be selective in those indications.
You have to be trained through the whole scope of retina surgery, not in one particular area alone.
So you are so right.
So you can actually select what the best method for the patient.
The biggest drawback, the biggest failure in people who are well trained in one area is that they can be excellent vitrectomists and they can be not very good ophthalmoscopists, you know. And I think that's the biggest failure that exists today, that there are these two schools of training, you know, and very few places, except for yours and ours and a few others, where both are combined. But in most places, they're not. And I think that's unfortunate.
Don't you feel with time there will be this increased blending of the two type of surgeons, so we'll have a true, good vitreoretinal surgeon? But also it seems to me that handling the more complicated cases, it just can't end there. You have to be a good corneal suture. You have to certainly know how to handle lenses. You have to know how to handle sclera and grafts, as well as just the vitreous and retina. So when you think about it, I think they have to be trained in all aspects of the surgery of the globe and trying to have a little expertise in all matters.
And we need to talk the same language too. You know, for example, open sky vitrectomy. The cases where open sky vitrectomies are performed cannot be done with internal vitrectomy. I'm convinced of that.
And the more procedures, I think the better results you're going to get.
That is, if you are critical, one procedure which I know enough about it. And I think that both of those, like you say, the combination of the internal as well as the open scavenger would be it.
Dr. Schepens, Dr. Pappas had one more question, which I think is very important. He said, if you could select from any one of your many accomplishments, which is the one item or event which you would like to be most remembered?
Well, I think that there is no single thing. I think, as I mentioned before, it's rather a class or group of events which makes me most satisfied. One is to have been able to develop such a wonderful friendship and collegiality with so many former trainees. The other is to have been able to play a role in the development of research accomplishments in the Eye Research Institute. And I think those two things are the things that stand out most, rather than, you know, having developed a thimble or a suture
or an indirect ophthalmoscope.
Or whatever.
Do you feel that there were, let me phrase it right, would you feel that there's any other country where would you have been able to accomplish what you have accomplished, except in the United States?
No, there is no other country. I'm quite firm and positive on that. Only in the States could that be done.
Now
he's an American. And then we could say that the United States is the country where your dreams can come true in a lifetime.
Absolutely.
And yours have come true.
Yes. Yes, because in the States, you know, they have the means, but they're willing to use the means. In other countries, they may have the means, they're not willing to use them. And then there are many stringency in other countries, you know. The system doesn't permit you to. Whereas in the States, if you don't like Boston, you know, go to Houston, go to California, you know. Nobody can interfere with that.
And you have many, many great friends that help you.
I sure have.
I think one thing, his dream might have come true, but he made many other students' dreams come true.
That's
and
correct.
I'm one of them, certainly.
That's correct.
I would be doing refractions, I can tell you.
That's right.
I never had an opportunity doing any surgery at all in my life. Oh, very little.
And compared
to what I have done.
You were a female ophthalmologist, and there were very few that could do surgery.
Yeah, he gave me a great honor of being the first female ophthalmologist accepted on the retina service. And I've always appreciated that. It's opened up a whole field of surgery for me, which I would never have had. And I just represent so many dozens and hundreds of students that you've trained, but I certainly want to thank you, Dr. Schepens.
Well, Alice, if this makes you happy, it couldn't happen to a better candidate than you.
Well, I certainly have been a wonderful, wonderful interview here. We learned a lot about Dr. Schepens, and thank you, both of you, for coming to Kansas City. Alice, you got up at 4 o'clock in the morning. You came all the way to Kansas City. You're flying back today.
I'd step all night
for
this.
I think that we will all enjoy it. This is something that's going to be a memento for future generations. Now, I am announcing now that in 10 years we need to have another one, and to make sure that somebody follows through on this, if I'm around, I certainly will. So thank you very much to both of you. It's been a great pleasure.
Well, thank you for inviting me, Felix. I certainly appreciate it, Dr. Schepens.
Thank you, Felix, for organizing this. I think it's been a lot of fun.